that required bedroom mix would be waived in this applicable zoning development districts, excuse me. This is a map showing the first of the four future, focus growth areas. It's North Main. The dark blue line includes that area. It may be hard to see, but it's basically the intersection of Laurel and North Main. The pictures that accompany this are examples of housing at densities that would comply with this code. This particular example is in the city of Oakland. It's 31 units to the acre as an example of what can be built. This is the North Main slash Soledad focus growth area. It is North Main Street, basically from the train tracks north, going up almost to the freeway, to 101, and it includes the Chinatown slash Soledad Street area. This example of 35 units to the acre is, I believe, in San Francisco. The South Main focus growth area is the South Main corridor, running roughly from the high school south down to Star Market and that area. This particular development is existing. It's in Salinas. It's 29 units to the acre. It was built by Interim several years ago on Sun Street. This is an example in this photo of 40 units to the acre, so at the top end of the scale. This project's in San Leandro, and this is the Abbott Street focus growth area, which is along the area where the auto dealers, you'll recall, used to be before they moved out to north on 101. Several other provisions in this zoning ordinance correct some typographical errors that we discovered while we were working on this. And other importantly, the other thing would be to add a provision allowing increased density within 2,500 feet of the intermodal transit center, which is commonly known as the train station. That's Station Place in downtown. Again, only on MX parcels that are located within either of these two areas. So the blue shaded area is the downtown neighborhood area, and the yellow shaded is focus growth area number two. So while the circle shows the entire radius, it would only work apply in the where the circle and the two shaded areas correspond. This, however, is not by right housing. This is conditional use permit. So there is, the city retains control over these projects as the developers bring them forward to us that want to build this at this higher density. The city would, it would go through the normal conditional use permit process through the Planning Commission to the City Council. So it's different from the other provisions I've discussed. Just touch on the community outreach that staff performed. We've had this ordinance posted in draft form on our website since the beginning of February. We provided an information letter to nonprofit housing providers and also a business organization such as SUBA, Old Town Salinas, the Chamber. We had a public hearing before the Planning Commission. That notice was published in the Californian. The notice of today's hearing was, of course, published in the Californian. Staff made presentations to the Chamber of Commerce Government Review Committee as well as to the Business Development Task Force, and then we subsequently met with some representatives from the Chamber's Government Review Committee. That concludes my report. I'm happy to answer any questions.
We'll go to council member for questions. Councilwoman Lutz.
Dave, it's couple of questions, really. It's frustrating to be assigned so many units by AMBAG, and I'm wondering if there's a way that we can protest it, or is it, I mean, it's, yeah. Can we protest AMBAG's decision?
I'm not sure I know the answer to that. It's, in one sense, it's water under the bridge. This decision was made several years ago,
understand.
And we've adopted a housing element based upon it. Looks like Tara may be able to shed some light on this.
The assignment of the residential units does come through, you know, the RENA process, which the various, you know, counties and cities all participate in, and it is based upon various factors that come from the state. And so we are able to accommodate all of those units within our projected unit counts, like with the future growth area and whatnot. The reason this was imposed is because it was there were specific concerns about having enough high-density residential units, and that's how we came up with the 1,200 approximate units that we needed. That was mandated by actually the state of California as opposed to AMBAG, and we are required to have that in order to have a valid approved
housing element. Thanks, Tara. Let me express a little frustration, because when Janet Barnes was on AMBAG, she worked really hard to try to fight for the lesser numbers. I want to make it clear, I'm not opposing density. A density can be done very, very well and can accommodate 52 units or more to the acre and done well. The problem that I have with this is that because it's allowed by right with no additional zoning conditions, what can we do about, say, impacts to traffic, design, compatibility with neighborhoods? You know, the pictures that you showed, Dave, are great, but how can we make sure that a developer is going to build that kind of development? Or are we going to get, I mean, Salinas has among the highest density neighborhoods in the nation. We all know that. We've talked about that many times. How can we get the quality investment, design, and project without being able to add any additional zoning conditions on a project?
Well, one of the things which occurred when we adopted our zoning code back, actually was in 2006, is that we used to have design guidelines, and guidelines are guidelines. They can be followed or not. But one of the things we did was we changed the guidelines to standards, and we also, you know, beef them up and put actual specific requirements that developments do need to follow. So now when people want to go and develop, especially in the mixed use areas, you know, we have actual guidance that is required. There's standards that people need to meet to make sure that they're architecturally enhanced, that they're attractive, that they reduce impacts to surrounding uses and whatnot. So that's something we didn't have, you know, a long time ago. Additionally, the areas where these will go into were visioned under the general plan to be higher density. They're closer to public services, transit, and that type of thing. So there was a vision that these would transition to more pedestrian-oriented, higher density types of uses. So it is consistent with the vision of the city to have infill development of a higher density. One of the reasons we chose the larger parcels was because we felt that you could address a lot of those impacts you're mentioning better than if you had smaller parcels that might directly abut residential uses and whatnot. So we think we have some measure of ensuring that there's going to not gonna be compatibility issues as a result of that.
So do you think our housing element and our land use elements are pretty strict in terms of being able to give us at least some control over what's going to be built? Or do we need to look again at those elements and figure out how we can be really, we just don't want to make the mistakes of the past.
Right. I think our zoning code, like I said, when we updated it, we did contain a lot, or did add a lot of provisions regarding design. It's just ensuring we enforce that and that we make sure that developments are coming up to that standard and that, you know, we have support to do that. So I think that's an important thing. One of the things that we, for example, did add as part of these regulations is that there would have to be, I believe it's an annual report that's submitted to ensure that maintenance and different things are being addressed so that facilities are being maintained. Because you might have a fairly nice complex initially, but then over the years it falls down, it's not maintained. So that was one thing we did add specifically to this. There's always room for improvement, of course. But I think if, like I said, we do look at our existing design standards and make sure that developments are incorporating those, we should end up with projects that are well designed.
Thank you. And if I could just ask one last quick question. Thank you. When we have the mixed use, how can we ensure that the retail portion is going to go in? Because I don't, again, the mistakes of the past, Tynan Village, all those empty shops below, which really is an invitation for blight, how do we prevent that?
Well, in regard to this code amendment, this is specifically allowing residential development, so it does not mandate that it has a commercial component. The mixed use was provided to provide, obviously, services and other uses in proximity to higher density residential uses, and we did provide a higher FAR and different things to encourage that to occur. Like I said, if somebody wants to build this higher density, we would not be imposing the mix that they have to have the commercial component.
But if they did, we'd make sure that they fulfilled that part of the bargain.
Well, obviously, if they're going to go for a mixed-use building and get those incentives, as we call them, such as reduced parking and whatnot, that does require that bottom floor be developed with a commercial type of use.
Perfect. Thanks, Tara.
Councilmember Castaneda, would you like to be next, sir?
Yes. I'm looking at the last page, community outreach. And it has a notice of public hearing published March 8th. And then on the last slide, in the middle, talking about proceeding to public hearing. So is a public hearing, has that been held, or is it going to be held?
As soon as you're through questioning me, I believe the mayor will open this meeting right now as a public hearing.
Okay, so this is the time to pretty much do.
Yes, sir, although we had a public hearing before the Planning Commission already.
Right.
As well.
For Councilwoman Joe Lutz, I think if we had mistakes in the past, and again, I'm the new councilman coming on, obviously I would not want to make those mistakes, and going more with the experience here, maybe this would be the time to go ahead and make whatever may constitute a protest or just a disagreement of not to go the same routes. So I would also echo the same feelings towards this. For the zoning, not too well familiar with the whole amendments, and there's going to be some future growth area and so forth. But the tiny village, if there was a significant errors made, then definitely not to go on that same route. So if there is a motion put forward by yourself or anyone else, I would definitely support that. Just looking at the presentation, very informational. We're down to the public hearing, like you mentioned. I guess this would probably be the most appropriate time to put anything out there for you. With for the city manager, Ray Corpus, I know you've been on the post for a little over a year now, but what would you recommend to this council in regards to not going that same route with Tynan Village or any other project similar to that?
Councilmember Castaneda, I think most projects of this type are driven by the market and funding. So in some cases, there are funds for affordable housing and mixed use. In other cases, there's affordable housing and commercial money available through the developer. And I think that's just a market-driven question. And Councilmember Lutz has a good point. You know, as we approve these projects and we look at the sort of the total package, it's our responsibility to make sure that the project meets expectations in terms of what they said they would do. So I think there are some ways to address that. But again, just like the housing market today is coming out of a recession, it's market driven.
Just a follow-up question on that for the city manager. Would that be to go in that route that you're mentioning? And, of course, it's driven by the market, driven by funding. Of course, what Councilwoman Lutz is bringing up is also something significant to add to this. Given all that information, would this be the time to go ahead and take some type of action? Obviously, it's a public hearing, or do we go ahead and hold this for a future either a study session or a future action item?
A couple of things I wanted to mention to clarify as well. This action is just going to provide for areas where these types of developments could could be potentially developed. Like I said, we're not authorizing any at this point. They'll have to go through additional review process, not discretionary, but we will be requiring them to go to meet all of our existing standards that we have, which, like I said, we do have standards for design and compatibility and things that did not exist when a lot of the developments that we're talking about were built. In fact, some of them weren't even in the city at the time. So there will be an additional process. It's just not like a CUP or something. The state requires it to be non-discretionary. The other thing I wanted to mention is that these units, although considered to be affordable from a state perspective because of the density, there's no requirement that they have to be affordable. So there, it's not going to be a requirement, for example, or you're not going to only see just affordable units. These could be market rate units, they could be luxury units, they could be any type of unit, a mix of units, they could be affordable units. So you're gonna have, like Ray said, they'll be market driven probably as far as what's going to go in there, and developers are gonna wanna be able to sell them if they're condominiums or rent them if they're apartments. And so if there's concerns about the type of development, you know, we can certainly look at a later time at you know, whether we need to make any improvements to our design standards. Like I said, we did make a lot of changes to those at the time of our last zoning code amendment, or update, excuse me.
Just to go back to the comments there, would those changes occur at a future council meeting, or this would be occurring at a different venue?
Well, if there was a concern that for some reason we wanted to revisit our design standards, we would do it at a future date. It's important to move forward with the approval of this, because if we do not approve the rezoning, we are going to be inconsistent with our housing element. We are required to have an approved housing element, or we risk, you know, not being able to get funding, grants, the state can step in. So it's one of those things. We can't say, well, there are ramifications to not adopt having an approved housing element.
I just wanted to make sure that we capture that it could be done at a later time versus just going through this and then we find out afterwards that we just can't revisit again. It's what's done, it's done.
Anything having to do with our zoning code and our design standards, absolutely, you know, can be looked at any point in time.
Okay.
If we feel that there's a need to beef them up or make changes to them. The important key point is to note we need to allow this density by right at this point in time and
gotcha.
Designate areas in order to implement our housing element.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, state legislative mandates as a part of housing are not going anywhere. I think we're going to see a lot more of this. And too great a government role, Tynan is a great example, can be dangerous. I spent 2 years on the Housing Advisory Commission for the County of Monterey, and my time on the Planning Commission led me to believe that we need flexibility and we need to believe in the marketplace. The second we start mandating, we really echo the actions of the state in this instance. I think that we've got design standards for a reason. We're doing this as we risk money if we don't. I mean, ultimately, considerable state funding and grants and whatever else come forward. And I guess to the point in the marketplace, you know, maybe you could speak a little bit about what the Business Development Task Force had to say, the GRC, maybe expand a little bit on just that. I know a lot of the development that has occurred in the city the last few years has been, for the most part, South County Housing, Chispa, you know, for the most part, low income, very low income, and projects that are backed by and funded by government. In the private sector is really what drives things in this community, and ultimately recovery and into the future will fall victim to largely state incentives or state direction, but in this case, development standards that are following suit. So maybe comment a little bit on the marketplace and what your crystal ball tells you about where the private sector and planning sits.
Unfortunately, I don't have a crystal ball. What's been developed lately, you're right on, the only funding that's been around for housing to be developed in California, as far as I'm aware, has been for given the crash that we had. It hasn't been for single family, it's been for multifamily, and it's only been subsidized in some way by the government. Either the housing authority is building the replacement of haciendas, or this nonprofit is building Gateway just down here on the corner. That's the only money that's been out there. So the market, in terms of the private sector, hasn't been playing. Hopefully they will come back as the recovery continues to gain speed, but it's anybody's game, anybody's guess, excuse me. That we do have, we did annex, of course, the whole future growth area with a mind of making land available so that developers could step forward, and we're hoping that that will happen over time. But at this point, that process is moving ahead very slowly. And I think it's because the developers still don't have financing or enough confidence that there'll be a market.
Well, maybe all the developers I hang out with are grumpy. I mean, the feedback I get is not on your dead body. You know, if it's hard enough to develop in Monterey County, it's even harder in Salinas. And so I guess I'm just looking for more feedback we got from, again, engaging the Business Development Task Force or the GRC at the Chamber. Was there no feedback?
There was no feedback. Excuse me, there was feedback, but the feedback related strictly to the parking standards.
Okay.
Some concern that they wouldn't be adequately parked. In other words, it's kind of a switch. Usually developers are telling us you're requiring too much. In this case, they're saying you're not requiring enough parking. But again, it wasn't a large-scale thing. It was a comment from one person on the Government Review Committee.
I mean, this might go more in, oh, sorry, Tara, yeah.
They also had some concerns about what the implications of this would be for the future growth area, and as we indicated, the specific plans will have to be adopted, and those will be subject basically to the regulations that are adopted as part of that. So they can have additional criteria in the specific plans beyond what this is providing. So that was the other comment area that they had. I think there was one comment, too, that they said they should provide for as much flexibility as possible.
Yeah, amen. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll go to my right for short comments. Okay, now we're going to move into, I beg your pardon? Okay. Well, to the point. We are now open for public hearing comments. Is there anyone from the public?
Marianne Warden. As far as those little windows there, they look like they're a prison windows. And the ones that were from North Salinas, they're ugly as sin. I've seen them in San Francisco, and they're still ugly. The ones South Salinas and Abbott, those are very nice looking ones. My question is there a play area for children? Is there, you mentioned the parking. Is there any community room or rooms that are going to be available for families can do computer work and stuff like some of our chispas places are? One of the main things with these apartments, if you're going to have families in there, you need to have a play area so they won't come out in the streets. We do not need any more high-density apartments here. We have them in the Alisal, and they were built after we came to the city, not before the city. We did not have any high density apartments out on Sanborn or anywhere else out there, because I know because I was living there. So just so you know, they weren't there. We had houses, homes with huge backyards, but we really don't need high density apartments. When you do that, you bring problems. We've seen it over and over in this city. North Salinas, where we have the high density, we have problems in there. We have gangs going in there. We have them out in the Alisal. We even have some over in South Salinas over here. We don't need lots of high density apartments. I've been there with the police. I've seen them all over town, not just out in the Alisal. So think about it.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the public that would like to comment at this time? Seeing none, we are going to go back to the council members to my right. Oh, I'm sure they have a lot to say at that end. Would you like to be first, Councilmember Barrera?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Mr. Swanson, it's good to see you. And thanks for the good report. You know, one of the things that I'm concerned about is a lot of times we're not holding, you know, with these projects are beautiful. I mean, they start out great. But then as the economy improves, you know, people look for investments. The reality right now, I think this would be the appropriate time to say these pictures look wonderful. But what happens after time goes by, Acosta Plaza, I remember in the 70s, nurses were going to move there. Teachers were going to move. Firefighters and police officers, man, it was going to be a wonderful place. Go look at Acosta Plaza now. Who do we blame? I mean, one of the things that the people several times blames government, I think we should go after these landlords that are just collecting their rents and not taking care of business. I mean, we have a serious problem out there. And as a matter of fact, I say no to apartments in the Alisal anymore because you know what? We have thousands of people living where hundreds should be living. The developments have been disastrous and we see it now 50 years later. I think these projects are wonderful as long as somehow we put in place that somebody's going to be responsible to make sure that we monitor these things because we have families. And, yeah, how do you kick out three families? Where are they going to go? But, you know, we have a serious issue where before you know it, you put some management in place, but then you have two families living in there. And It's a bad problem, but thank you for this. I think it's a great concept, but we need a lot of work on this. Thank you.
We're going to go back down to my left. They have a few comments.
I will keep it short, Mayor, I promise. Actually, all I really want to say is, you know, I'm be happy to introduce the ordinance. You know, I wanted to make it clear, of course we have concerns, but, you know, density is not the bad guy per se. If you look at, say, Holland, Amsterdam has the highest densities in the world and also among the highest standard of living. So, it depends on how we do it. And understanding that, you know, you're absolutely right, Marianne. I mean, most of the stuff that was built in the LSL was built 50 years ago when everybody sitting up here lived within like two blocks of each other and were making decisions for areas that were far away from where they lived. And so we've certainly come a long way in terms of being able to represent the city more fairly. But I just think that, and I appreciate Jose Castaneda bringing up things that we want to just be prepared. We want to be able to make sure that even though we can't add additional zoning conditions, we can at least make sure that those design standards, you know, are in effect. And I know, Tara, that you do a fabulous job. So I know as long as you're here, we'll have those, we'll have to adhere to standards. And the only other thing I want to add is that we need to remember, too, that none of these are going into the LSL. So I think that's important to bring up that they are, I know, and they're not. They're going they're going into her district, so it's okay for us. But remember, too, that when we're talking about high density, it can also be beautiful homes and for people that, you know, could be retirees, could be upper end, moderate, or low income. I mean, it can really be the gamut. So we'll hope that this all works out well, and this could be a very exciting time for Salinas.
Councilmember Castaneda.
No, I think we had enough. In anything in the future, we'll look at that.
What?
If we had enough. But I will talk about what Councilmember Tony Barrera was mentioning. We live in the high density area, so Marianne Warden also hit it right on the nail on the head there, that those projects have been done after the fact. So even though they're going in Councilwoman Craig's district area, we still need to look at these with with a fine eye as well. So, thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember McShane, they're going in your district.
Planning is one of our greatest responsibilities, right behind public safety. This has got to be taken seriously. I think planning, void of engaging stakeholders, is a major challenge. I think of planners and developers like dogs and cats. In some communities, they're much closer, but I think about that. And maybe I'm just talking to the grumpy ones, but if there's really good coffee and lots of outreach and opportunity to work closer, I think that's a positive thing. And the greatest challenge is when we respond just because we're being told to by the state. This is well put together. My compliments, going through it, you've done a great job. The challenge is with the marketplace where it's at, we're not hearing from folks out there because they're grumpy and there just isn't much going on. I think moving forward, the more that we can do, the better. Flexibility on our side is important. You see that, Tara. You see that, Mr. Swanson. It's important that we've got that. I'd second this. We still got some time. we got to keep this moving along, no doubt about it. But I thank you for your work on this.
Okay, we had an introduction by Councilwoman Lutz, I understand.
Let's move along.
And I don't believe we need to take a vote on this. No, it'll be coming back on April the 23rd.
You would need to make a motion for this. This is introduction.
It's introduction.
Out of an ordinance.
You had a second?
Sure.
And we need a vote on it?
Actually, Tara, the way we do it is we just introduce it this time, then we have the second reading, and we do the formal
then
vote
we do
at the second,
right,
second,
there's
a second reading.
Point of clarification, Mayor. Under the government code and the Ralph M. Brown Act, it's introduced to the public as a public hearing. So that does change the dynamics if we have to take a vote on this for action. I think to the chief legal advisor, we either, with the consensus of this whole entire council, we change that, which can not be transparent. And the other part, under my only understanding, that for the only thing that we're doing for action here is consideration. So it's not listed under considerations. Therefore, there is no motion or second needed for this, unless I'm misunderstanding this. It's a public hearing.
And Tara, you can clarify this, but I think that the whole it has been noticed as a public hearing, as you're noting, council member, to provide the public an opportunity to review the ordinance with the council and provide comment. And I believe it was it noticed as an introduction of the ordinance or just a public hearing concerning the ordinance? Regardless, I think that we will come back. That second public hearing has also been noticed on the 23rd, is my understanding. So that would be the final opportunity for the public to, or is this the sole public hearing that you're I think this is?
This is the public hearing.
Right.
The next one would just be.
We're just voting that to adopt the ordinance.
You're adopting a resolution, or you're adopting an
ordinance. You're adopting
ordinance.
The ordinance,
yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is the sole public hearing, but the only action that the council is taking today is to introduce the ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
Does that answer your question?
That's my understanding, and that's what I want to make sure we get this clarified, because if we do take action, then we can be challenged by a member of the public, and then we'll be with a 30-day cure and correct, and we don't want to go through that process. So even in the worst-case scenario, definitely want to bring it for the future meeting, but I think what suffice for today is a public hearing. That's on the record, and that's my understanding. Okay.
I guess we're done on this issue now. The council is going to take about a 10-minute recess. We'll be back at 6:44. Item would be the draft plan for 2013-2014 Community Development Block Grant CDBG Home Investment Partnerships, Home and Emergency Solutions Grant, ESG Funding, Proposals and Recommendations. We will now receive a report from Grace Aston, the planning manager.
Mr. Mayor, if I may, prior to, and I apologize, Grace, my public relations company, K Craig Media, does contract work with the Housing Authority. And even though it is a minute part of this action plan. I'm going to be abstaining from the discussion and voting on the matter, and I'm going to need to leave the room. But one thing I would ask, just respectfully, of this council, this is the draft action plan that's being presented tonight. If you could consider giving direction to city staff to please segment the decisions on this matter so that I can actually participate in the discussion and the voting on May 7th. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, Mayor, City Council members. The purpose of today's meeting is to present the draft action plan to the council to set the stage for the May 7th meeting where the action plan will be adopted. Public comment was solicited for today's public meeting and the May 7th public hearing, and both meetings have been duly noticed in the Californian on March 26th and in the El Sol on March 23rd. And if you want to just briefly look at the slide, here are the key dates. We started the RFP process back in December. Just going down the line, we're now presenting the draft April 9th, and we are planning to adopt the final action plan on May 7th and subsequently submit the action plan on May 15th to meet the HUD requirement of receiving the action plan by 45 days before the end of the plan year. So let's begin with the overall allocations. You'll also find these figures on the bottom part of the action plan spreadsheet, which is in the council packet. As of today, the city has not received the final allocations from HUD, and so the plan is based upon the following estimated amounts. The total fiscal year 13-14 new funds for CDBG, ESG, and Home is $2.4 million, and that's the first column on the left. And that reflects a 5% CDBG decrease, and ESG as well, and then a 4% home decrease. More recent information indicates that we may be getting additional allocations in CDBG and ESG funding. So what we'll do is we'll apply the either, you know, the increase or whatever that amount is across the board. And as I mentioned, we'll present to council on May 7th. You'll see the next column reflects projected unused funds, or we also call it carryover funds. Again, that number is estimated, and it's composed of any excess and unallocated program income and estimated unused project funds. And then we have an estimated program income at $88,000, bringing our total to $3.79 million. You'll see here the proposed amounts in terms of categories. I'll go over each of those categories and the funding recommendations. I do want to point out that in comparison to last year's total, the amount is slightly higher despite the anticipated, the estimated decreases in our estimates. And that is due to any excess unallocated program and estimated unused project funds that I mentioned in the previous slide. So the first category is administration and program delivery. And just to remind council, CDBG admin costs are limited to 20% of the annual allocation, home 10%, and ESG 7.5%. Our budget items include staff salaries, materials, supplies, training costs, outside services, legal publications, and we also pay rent and overhead charges to the city general fund. In the past, we've had enough funds to maintain 8.5 staff members and pay for these other division costs, but due to the significant decline of CDBG and home funds during the past few years, and also without support from city general funds, two positions were eliminated, and that took effect last year in July. In order to meet the existing work demands, also with increasing and changing HUD regulations and additional administrative burdens created by the dissolution of the City Redevelopment Agency, we restored the half-time city analyst position to full-time. We also shifted some of the tasks among several staff members, and we also relocated to the 65 West Allisal office in July. So this draft plan provides staff funding to maintain the division's current staff level. However, I want to bring your attention to the highlighted item under NSP. This amount, $187,000, represents a portion of program income that may be used for staff salaries, and it's calculated based on proceeds of projected NSP home sales. So there is a potential deficit of about $22,000 using a conservative projection, but what we're trying to do now is bring some additional revenue in case of that worst-case scenario. Housing staff has begun to look into contracting out the city's housing staff to assist in coordinating other jurisdictions' rehab or first-time homebuyer program. And this action was recommended by the Council Housing Subcommittee at its April 2nd meeting. And moving on to affordable housing, we have two pending recommendations, one for Vista de la Terraza project and the Hacienda's Phase 2 project. And the third item there, for the third year, we are recommending an allocation to the agency Rebuilding Together Monterey Salinas for their single family dwelling repair program. Due to a last minute proposal withdrawal from the Gateway Apartments and recent housing staff shortage, we're asking for additional time to complete project feasibility and eligibility for the Vista project and Hacienda's 2 project. And we'd like to return to council on May 7th for a final recommendation. I do want to assure you that staff is working together with CHISPA with regards to Vista in order to move this 40-unit rehab project forward. And at the same time, we're working diligently to ensure project feasibility under the HUD programs and that the city meets current and new requirements under the new Home 2014 Appropriations Act. This includes a new certification now required of the city stating that staff has assessed the developer's capacity and financial condition, that there is a market need for the project, and that there is long-term project viability before we commit home funds. Lastly, under this category regarding Hacienda's 2, you'll recall that council approved a temporary city general fund loan for deferral of the project's development fees until home funds are available. So that's that $410,000 home funding that's pending. Okay. The city continues to operate the housing rehabilitation program and the housing accessibility programs. And here you see the target units for the plan year and the recommended amounts. Under public facilities and improvements, we received 6 applications under this category. However, due to lack of CDBG funds, staff is recommending funding for the following 5 projects. And under economic development, the city is moving forward with its Grow Salinas Fund program, which provides low-cost loans to small businesses. We've had a lot of interest from the small business community, and staff is near its first loan closing. The National Development Council has been assisting the city with this program, as well as the city's Section 108 loan application, will be able to provide $750,000 of matching loan funds to the initial $250,000 CDBG allocation. So we are recommending an additional $150,000 this next fiscal year. This next slide is half of the recommendation for CDBG Public Services. You'll see a column for a total funding request, the staff recommendation on the next column, and then the subcommittee's recommendation at the March 18, 2013 meeting. HUD limits the public services amount to 15% of the annual CDBG location, and so we are working with an estimated amount of $275,000. And last year, the committee provided staff direction to allocate CDBG public services using 4 categories as part of the CDBG funding parameters: fair housing, neighborhood services, senior, and youth, and set aside percentages for allocation for each category. This year, we only received 2 applications under fair housing, and so you'll notice that the staff recommendation did not equal the available amount, and we waited for additional guidance from the subcommittee to get to the 275. At the meeting, the committee also recommended a one-time exemption to the set-aside percentage and also established the minimum allocation amount at $10,000. We will come back to council on May 7th for the adoption of the revised CDBG funding parameters. And as mentioned earlier, we're using an estimated 5% reduction for ESG, which brings the available amount to $182,860. Proposals were received from the five agencies currently supported with CDESG funds for six programs. As required under the Hearth Act, we did consult with the Area Continuum of Care led by Tom Melville at the same March 18th subcommittee meeting. One new application for the Natividad Shelter Program was received. However, due to lack of ESG funding recommendations were made for the rest of the five programs. And relocation and contingency funds are recommended to cover any cost overruns, any relocation requests within the plan year. And so I want to point out that these amounts do include the pending allocations for Vista and Haciendas, as I've previously mentioned. We do maintain a small contingency amount due to timeliness requirements for both CDBG and home programs. And just, I finally want to just take the time to thank the entire housing division staff for the work this year, their commitment, their passion for what we do in housing, for Alan and Jeff's support, and just really kind of teaming up with us to come up with creative solutions. Just some honorable mentions, other staff members, Vanessa, Chris, and their staff, Matt Miguel and Beth in finance, and Gary and public works staff, Courtney and Joey staff. So we work with all of those people to get to this plan, and really everybody had to pull together a lot this year to make things happen. So I'd like to ask council to provide direction regarding the proposed allocations and actions, and staff will come back on May 7th for a final adoption of the plan.
All right, we'll now open it up for council member questions. Councilmember Barrera.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Ms. Aston, as well as always, it's good to see you and a fine report here. Can you just, I was reading the report on Vista de la Terraza. Where are, I mean, layman's terms here, what is going to happen with your request here, what to develop this place?
Yeah, so we are working closely hand in hand with CHISPA staff. We want to ensure that the funding is whole before we commit any funds. Again, with the staffing shortage that has recently happened, we didn't have enough time to completely analyze the project. There are also a couple of moving pieces with their existing RHCP loan. And we also received some late information with regards to the former redevelopment funds that were initially, if you would recall, initially was there and not there, and now it's we're hoping that it's going to be available on January 2014. So we have to put all those pieces together so that when HUD comes to say, did you do your feasibility? Yes, we did.
And you're saying this is going to be happening when?
The acquisition will need to happen October, let me see, October 2013.
So it looks like we are going forward and working on this project.
Yes, and that's our intent is to move this forward, especially with the initial $350,000 that we already have allocated in CDBG funds.
And just another question on the Firehouse Recreation Center. Do we know if, I know at one time the apartment owners next door, I don't know if it was, they were giving like $17,000 for the kids in that neighborhood. Is that still happening? Do you know?
I'm not familiar with Do we have anybody from Rec?
Ms. Velada, Ms. Ma, yeah, there was, I know at one time, Mr. Stump, am I right on that?
Yes, that's correct, Council Member. That was part of their tax credit financing requirement for Los Padres Apartments, that they provide funding. Actually, they had insufficient on-site location to provide programs. So I presume that that funding continues on an annual basis, yes. But we'll double check with finance and Rec Park to make sure.
Yeah, and I would like to know that. I mean, because I think it's a great partnership. So if that is happening, that's on top of the 27, or should I say 19,000 that the committee is recommending. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And just one last, Mr. Mayor, if I may. Now it's the right over here.
You're entitled.
Thank you, sir. On second chance, what is the status as far as, because I hear that they're doing very, and I just hear these things, that they're doing very well as far as they got this, like a $500,000 grant where they've been hiring quite a few counselors out there. And I'm thinking if they already have big money, and I don't know this for sure, I believe I read it in the paper somewhere. So if there's $500,000 that Second Chance has, and we're giving them, we're a generous group here, $13,000, I would just like to know about that, because I would like to see helping somebody else that maybe doesn't have $500,000 there. Thank you, Ms. Heston. Okay.
Thank you, Councilman. Council Member McShane?
Sure. So I think one of the biggest challenges that, you know, staff faces is keeping up with so many requests. I know that site visits have been a challenge for, mm-hmm. you know, follow-up as required by the federal funding sources. Maybe you can comment just a little bit on how you're able to keep up, I guess, more than anything. What are your plans looking at? And granted, it'd be nice if there's, you know, a bump in CDBG and ESG, but still they're limited. And you've learned a lot, and I think the staff's learned to kind of be a little bit more scrappy. We had a meeting maybe 3-4 months back to talk about ways that we could incentivize collaboration, leverage, you know, organizations coming together under some of the funding parameters and some of the goals set out by the subcommittee. Can you comment just a little bit on those two subjects? One, how is a limited staff keeping up with administration of the various funds? And then two, working towards incentivizing providers to collaborate?
Sure. Well, definitely this year, with the loss of two staff members, a turnover, it's a big impact on our staff. And we do have a list of back burner items already that we haven't been able to respond to, even from 3 years ago. We're just bracing for what HUD might be sending our way. We are preparing in that manner, trying to respond to the most important compliance items. Monitoring, we are behind on our monitoring tasks. However, we are looking forward to some stabilization with staff in the next couple months. And I feel that we will be able to collaborate more with other agencies, such as doing shared monitoring with, for example, the City of Monterey. We have talked about this for a long time. Again, it is a matter of the staff trying to implement these different creative solutions. We've also been making headway with our City Data Services database management system. What I've received so far feedback from our sub-recipients is that they do like the system, and we are constantly, almost on a every week or every couple weeks basis, implementing improvements. So that's been going well. We did try to kind of brainstorm on the consortium idea, but at this point, I think we're waiting to see how the streamlining efforts are going to play out with the city data services.
Sure.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, and maybe one last question when it comes to technology. I mean, everything's filed electronically now and the regular reporting and everything else, and obviously that's
yes.
helped quite a bit.
It's helped quite a bit as opposed to running reports manually. We're now able to generate timeliness reports. That's really helped with the subcommittee meeting this week. This year, where we were just able to run a spreadsheet out of the system showing us who was late. There are still obviously some bugs, and staff's really committed to tweaking the system so that it's really useful, not just for us, but also for our subrecipients.
Okay. That's all for now.
Councilwoman.
Just have comments, so I'll wait until later.
Okay, we're now going to open it up for public comment on these issues. Anyone with public comment, please step up.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. My name is Alfred Diaz-Infante, President and CEO of Chispa. I'm here to speak specifically about Vista La Terraza. With me this evening is Paul Tran, our project manager, as well as Blanca Sarasua, the attorney representing the residents of Vista La Terraza. And as well, we have some of our residents that are here. I want to acknowledge and thank your staff. We had a meeting with them yesterday with Grace Aston, Anna Velasquez, Alan Stump, Matt Pressey, as well as Jeff Weir. And we are working together to come to an agreement in terms of how all the findings are going to come together so that we can find a solution for this housing complex. It has a long history. Those of you that have been on the City Council know that history, but it has a very long history, and I think we're finally coming together, and so we continue to work together, and again, want to acknowledge your staff for working with us, and there's been some really good cooperation, so thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and Honorable Members of the City Council. Blanca Sarasua, Legal Counsel for Vista La Terraza. It's been a long haul in terms of this issue being addressed before you as a City Council, and we've been working very closely with Chispa, and we want to continue certainly working with the City of Salinas. My clients are very resilient, and financially they have very few options. We want to thank you for your leadership, and we look forward to seeing you in May. I have a couple of ladies who are board members of Vista La Terraza who would like to make some brief comments. Maria Garcia, Secretary.
Buenas tardes a toda la mesa de directiva del concilio. Mi nombre es María García y soy la secretaria de la mesa directiva de Vista de la Terraza. Y yo particularmente estoy representando aquí a todas las familias que están, que somos de la cooperativa. Y quiero decirles que no esperemos a que pase un accidente porque Vista de la Terraza está en muy mal estado y ocupa muchas reparaciones.
Va a traducir.
Ah, okay, sorry. Okay. Y está ocupando muchas reparaciones y necesitamos para de su apoyo. Hoy estamos aquí porque queremos su apoyo de todos ustedes. Gracias.
Good evening to all members. My name is Maria Garcia, and I'm the secretary of the Board of Directors, and I'm here particularly representing all the families of Vista de la Terraza, and I want to tell you we are not hoping, not waiting until there is an accident, because at Vista de la Terraza, they're in a really bad shape, and they're in desperate need of repair. And that is why we need your support. Thank you.
Ah, Sí, buenas noches. Mi nombre es Mayra González y soy la tesorera de la cooperativa de Vista de la Terraza. María y yo representamos con orgullo Vista de la Terraza. Agradecemos su liderazgo y lo respetamos en todas sus decisiones. Estaremos aquí de nuevo el 7 de mayo. Esperamos conservar a nuestras familias unidas y sanas. Muchas gracias.